I'm excited this morning. We're very honored to have a missionary with us in service. Fari Rider comes to us from Taiwan via Tecumseh, Oklahoma. Her mom and dad were veteran pastors in Tecumseh for a long time and fixtures in the Oklahoma district for forever and ever. And with such great upbringing, Fari has a great legacy that she brings to us this morning, not just of her own ability and her own calling, but she's riding on the shoulders of a great mom and dad who blazed the trail so that she could have what she is enjoying this morning. And the people that she has touched probably could not be counted here in Oklahoma and especially in Taiwan, but I am very honored to have her with us this morning. She's dedicated her life to the mission field, and she has touched hundreds and hundreds and probably thousands of lives. So I'm excited to have her with us this morning, and she has brought some girls with her from Taiwan, and they're going to come and minister to us right now. So give them a big hand as they come. Would you do it?
Praise God. Isn't it wonderful for the grace and the power of God in our lives that changes lives every day? I'm so grateful to be able to be here with you today and be able to share with you what you're doing in the nation of Taiwan and what God is doing by the power of His Holy Spirit. We're really excited about the things that are taking place, and we're excited that you partner with us, that you send me, and that you keep us in your prayers, and you keep supporting us every month, and faithful throughout the years, the many years that I've been there. You've been faithful, and I just want to say thank you because you're making a difference in lives. I know what you just saw right there is what we look at and we think, oh, that's a performance. But it's a outward performance of what really takes place in the spirit world, what God does in our lives, how He changes lives every day. And today I just want to share with you some of those testimonies. But before I do that, let me as just reiterate what Pastor Kelly has said. I was born and raised here in Tecumseh, Oklahoma, and I grew up here in Oklahoma, and God called me to the mission field at the age of 15. And I knew at that time that's where God wanted me to go was Taiwan. And I, from that moment on, I knew that's what God wanted me to do. And I still remember I see Pastor Goins sitting back there. Brother Goins is a longtime friend of the family. And, of course, my dad and his father, this Brother Goins, Pastor Kelly's grandfather, were really close friends through the years, so I knew a lot of them. But I remember Brother Goins as I met the missions committee for the first time 24 years ago, as you sat on that committee, and I'll never forget what you said as you sat on that committee. You spoke up and you said, Fari knows God's call on her life, and as I've watched her life, I know that she set her face like a flint and said, that's where God wants me, and that's where I'm going to be. And I believe that God has called her. And can I tell you, Brother Goins, I appreciate so much your faith in the call of God in my life. And I appreciate all those that have supported. You guys, we are a team. We work together to win the nation of Taiwan. And we're seeing God just do it by His Spirit. And I just want to share some things. If we could go to the PowerPoint real quick. God has really blessed the ministry. What we've been able to do is I began a ministry called Children's Lane. It's children's evangelism. As I've said before, as I've been here, what we do is we go into the public schools and we share the gospel with the kids in the public schools. Yes, we're able to do that. We're able to stand on a stage and share the gospel. We present a program that's about 40 minutes long. And at the end of the program, we give every kid a book of hope. Now, this book is the gospel of Jesus Christ, all the way from Genesis to where Jesus died on the cross, where He rose again, where He ascended. And at the end of the book, it tells the kids how they can accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. We have different books for different ages. This is only first through fourth grade. Then we go fifth through sixth grade. Then we have junior high, high school, college age. And we also have teacher's books. So the teachers are able to go with the student, go through these books with the students, which is really exciting. And in 2013, it was really exciting. We passed the 1 million mark of students that had received the Book of Hope and had received, actually heard the gospel. Actually, it went over that. And then in 2015, the end of 2015, now into 2016, we've passed another million. So 2 million people have already heard the gospel. 2 million students. It's increasing. If you'll notice, as I said, over the past 2 years, another million had heard. I mean, we are picking up speed. You want to know why? Because the end is coming. And God is just opening doors left and right, saying, get the message to the people. Get the message to the people. No matter where they are, if they're willing to hear, get the message to them. And I want to share with you a testimony. If you go to the next slide, you'll see this little girl. Her name is Yashin. And last summer, as we went to the schools and we began to share the gospel, we took a team with us from Southwestern Assemblies of God University. They came over and they passed out the Book of Hope to almost 9,000 students while they were there. And Yashin just happened to be one of those girls that got a Book of Hope. And as she took that Book of Hope and she read it, she believed it, and she accepted Jesus Christ as her personal Savior. But the story doesn't end there. Yashin, she began to pray for her parents because, you know, in Taiwan, most of the people in Taiwan are Buddhist or Taoist, which means most of the people there, they believe in spirits. They believe in gods. They believe in many gods. And many times, parents, they don't mind if their kids attend church, but they definitely don't want them to commit their lives to Jesus Christ, because they understand that a commitment to Jesus Christ means you're going to turn away from all idols and you're going to serve him and him alone. And Yashim began to pray for her parents. Well, one day her father walks into her room. He looks at her room, and like fathers do sometimes, he looks at it and thinks, this is a mess. My girl's room is a mess. Instead of calling Yashim to come and to pick up her room, he goes and he starts to straighten it up himself. And guess what falls on the floor? A book of hope. When he picks a book up, he tells us later, he gets halfway through the book and he realizes, this is what I've been looking for. This is the answers to the questions I have in my life. How many of you know God's word is powerful. God's word will not return void. And I can tell you this, if we can get God's word into the hands of kids, it's not only the kids' lives who are affected, it's their families' lives. He finished reading the book, and at the end of the book, he accepted Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. Go to the next slide. He led his wife to the Lord through this book. A simple book. The gospel is simple. It was never meant to be difficult. It is simple. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And that's what it's about. And they're sharing their testimony in December. This was last summer they accepted Christ. December they share their testimony in the next slide. They're preparing to be baptized in water, which they were in December. It's so exciting. It's so exciting to see how God is not only changing the lives of kids, but changing the lives of their parents too. I want to tell another story because I've not only been involved in children's ministries as far as going out and doing evangelism, but I've also been the Christian education director for camps and for the Taiwan District Council. So we do kids camp in the summer. And this is a story in the next slide. You'll see of a little boy in the middle. His name is Jingping. Jingping was, he's 9 years old. And Jingping is a thief. He's a little boy in the blue. Jingping is a thief, and he's not a very good one. By the way, he's been caught many, many times, and he's been taken into custody so many times. And the judge looked at Jingping and said to Jingping, Jingping, I'm sending you to the orphanage. And you're going to the orphanage, and if you don't get your life together, if you don't change, I'm going to send you to prison. I'm going to put you in jail. There's nothing else I can do, even if you're 9 years old, because you don't quit breaking the law. Well, Linda came to me, and that's Linda over there who just walked through the door in the purple shirt, and she's like, oh, man, oh, man. Yeah, Linda came to me in 2014. She is my coworker. She's been working with me full-time for 18 years full-time. And she came to me in 2014. She said, Fari, do you think we can invite the kids from the orphanage to come to kids camp? And I said, of course. You got the money? I mean, it takes a lot of money. And Linda said, I believe God's going to provide the money. And you know, God did. He provided the money for the whole orphanage to come to camp. And before they came to camp, the director talked to me and said, now this little boy, Jingping, you've got to watch out for him because this kid steals all the time. He will steal every day. He will steal everywhere. He will steal anything. And if he walks in a door and he leaves, you better check his pockets, check everything. He's probably taken something from that room because he just steals all the time. He's stolen from all of his orphanage mates. He's stolen from the teachers at the orphanage. He just steals from everybody. So you got to watch this kid. So it's the first night of camp. You know, we're up there. We're having a good time. We invite the kids, come worship. And this is Jingping. He comes to the front. He's standing at the front. And I'm at the front. And I'm looking at Jingping and I'm watching his hands. Where's he putting his hands? What's going on? How many of you know God was watching him so much closer than me? He always does. God looks at the heart. We just look at the outward, and we think we got it figured out. But God knows he goes a lot deeper. And he was watching Jingping that night, too. And at the end of the service, when they gave the altar call, Jingping came and gave his life to Jesus Christ. Now, I'm not talking about just praying a simple sinner's prayer. You know, my dad used to always say, and this is not in the Bible, so don't bother to look it up. But my dad used to always say, you know how somebody's prayed through is when their tears meet their snot. Now, I know it's not biblical, but he believed it. And I could tell you, this kid's tears met his snot every night of that camp. Every night of the camp. You'll see in the next slide, as Jingping is praying with the counselors, as he's pouring out his heart to Jesus Christ, as he's giving him everything he's got. And on the fourth day of camp, the director from the orphanage, she comes to visit her kids. And when she arrives, Jingping goes running to meet her. And he runs up to her and he says, I haven't stolen anything for 4 days. She could not believe it. She comes to me and she says, is this true? Has Jinping not stolen anything for 4 days? And I said, it's absolutely true. And she said, how can this be true? And I said, because God has changed this boy's life. God. You see, that's what it's all about. It's not about great programs. And we have great programs, believe me. It's not about that. It's about the power of God. It's about the Spirit of God that can change a heart in a matter of time where it takes us forever to try to change someone. It's almost, it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. And he can change any heart. Doesn't matter what your past is. Doesn't matter where you've come from. Doesn't matter what you've done. God can change your life just like he changed Jinping's life. And I can tell you, we've been keeping up with this young man. He needs your prayers. He needs a lot of prayers. He came from a horrible background situation. And I can't tell you his story, but I could tell you this. It's a horrible story from his mom and what happened to his life. And I never make excuses. Kids that work with me know I never let them get by with, oh, I'm just this way. I can't help it. I never do that. But I can tell you, this kid has been through a lot, but God has changed his life. And at the end of camp, he wrote these words. He said, I've never experienced so much love in all my life as I experienced at this camp. If you'll go to the next slide. And he said, I believe Jesus has forgiven me of my sins. And I believe he has the power to help me change my life. And he does. He does have that power. And you know what? Speaking on power, I'm going to ask Linda to come right now. And she's going to be shocked. But Linda, get up here. Quick. Quick. Linda came to the United States in 1999 to attend our kids' camp because I wanted her to get more involved and to know what was going on here in Oklahoma. And I want Linda to share a little bit of her testimony. She did this week at kids' camp, and it's a powerful testimony of how God works.
How many minutes do I have? Hi, my name is Linda. I give you a little bit of my background. Jinping, we stayed at the same orphanage. I was 4 months old, and my mom passed away. So my dad is blind, and we were very poor. And my uncle put us to an orphanage for 17 years. So my 17 years is all in the orphanage, but I have a good time. And because it was founded by American missionaries, it's a Presbyterian. So the way we do service is very quiet. So they talk about God. I know God. I know everything. I know the Bibles. But talking about Holy Spirit, this part, this area is very, very untouchable. Like, it's very holy. So the only thing I know Holy Spirit is inside my heart. That's all. So in 1999, I came to Oklahoma. That's my first time. And then Fari invited me to come. But before I came, the 2 years I've been working so hard. I just graduated and working for 2 years. But in these 2 years, I have a lot of things happen in my life. I worked in a Christian company, and we're doing crusades, like singing, do at a school, stuff like that. And I see ugly side of Christians, and I meet a lot of pastors or ministers, and I see the way they act. It doesn't match the way I understand about Christian. So I thought, I'm in a Christian company, and so I'm supposed to be like a paradise, happy all the time, it's because we're all Christian. Because you know Taiwan, only 3% Christians. So I'm the very, very little. So finally, I get to this environment, so I'm so happy. Because when I was little, from first grade to sixth grade, they have some 调查. They do, check all the kids' background, but they do it in public. So this is what they do. Okay, how many of you are Christian? Please raise your hands. We have about 50 to 60 kids in one class. So I'm the only one who raised my hand. So embarrassed. So I put down my hand. Okay, next question. How many of you are Native Americans? No, not Native Americans. Native Indians in Taiwan. In Taiwan, it has Indians, like Aborigine. So I look around. I'm the only one raising my hands again. I'm so ashamed about it. Because Aborigine in Taiwan, the position is very, very low. They look down on you, that you're the lowest class in the society. So I raise my hands again. Okay, I put it down. I said, please, get this over. And then, okay, next question. How many of you stay in the orphanage now? So I look around. I'm the only one. So I'm the only one raised my hands in the whole class. I'm so embarrassed about it. Until sixth grade, same things happen. So I have a very, very low self-esteem, very, very low. And then I don't talk at all in class, or I don't talk in public. Even among three people, I don't talk. So people thought I'm mute. Only when I get back to the orphanage, I feel safe. When I go out of the orphanage, I don't talk at all. So when I'm in college, my classmate thought I don't talk. Very quiet person. But 1999, I came to kids camp, Oklahoma kids camp. And I saw kids worship God like adults. They just raise their hands and then they close their eyes and then cry and then sing. Like it's really worship. But in Taiwan, I don't get to see those. Because in Presbyterian church, they're all quiet, singing a hymn book and then sit down and up hymn book and read the Bible and sit down. That's all they do. So when I saw kids raise their hands and singing so loud and they're so happy and into worship, I said, it can't be true. I think they've been taught to do this way. So maybe they pretend like they're adult. But the first night is this way, second night is the third night is this way. I said, this way you cannot pretend so well, like 100% actors. So I said, this can't be true. So I said, then I started to think about my belief about worship God, my belief about Jesus. If he is really insist, or is just the knowledge in my mind. So on the Wednesday night, I was praying for one of the girl. I thought adults supposed to pray for the kids. So I'm the adult, so I went to the altar to pray for the kids. So while I'm praying for the kids, and the kids were start to speak in tongue. And then some of the kids fall down and cry. Some of the kids just start speaking in tongues. Some of the kids just shout. Some start to dance. I said, whoa, what's going on? And I said, this can be happen because they're children. How can they perform like being baptized in the Holy Spirit? I saw it in Taiwan in my church. But when I saw them, they always do crazy things. And when pastor pray for them and they fall on the floor, I said, boom, what happened? I didn't understand because my background is Presbyterian. So many things up and then they roll here and laughs. I have no idea what's going on until I came to kids camp. I saw what happened to the kids. So I know, I think this is real. So while I'm praying for the kids, one of the girl, and she starts to speak in tongue and I understand. So what? I understand what she's talking. So while she say, Jesus is the Lord in Mandarin, I look at Fari. Fari just give me the look, blink. So I said, I think she heard it too. And second time, she spoke in tongue again, Jesus is the Lord. Very clear and very correct tone. I say, these four words is very difficult to pronounce in Chinese. Even I don't think they can get it really perfect. Even they speak in Chinese. So I said, it can't be. She's American. If she, maybe she was raised in China, maybe. I was thinking. So that night when I went back to the dorm, I was thinking, God, if Holy Spirit is true, can change your life, can refresh your spirit again. I said, this is what I want. Because I came with broken heart, broken body. And I don't want to go back to Taiwan the same way I am now. So that night, I just say, okay, no matter what happened tomorrow night, even I'm wearing skirts, I'm pretty athletic. So I run pretty fast, roll pretty fast. So I was worried, what if I was baptized in the Holy Spirit? What will I do? Because I saw what kids did at the platform. They said, I don't think they can catch me. So I was worried. But at that moment, I said, no matter what happened, I'm going. I want to be changed. I made up my mind. So on Thursday night, I went. I'm so scared, but I didn't see any adults there. And so I still went. I just go there. I didn't pray for the kids. I just stand in front of the altar, and then I start to pray. When I start to pray, there's one hand lay on top of me. I thought it's one of the teacher or coach praying for me. So I peek. Oh, it's a little boy praying for me. It can't be happen, because in Taiwan, kids doesn't pray for adults. It's adult praying for you. We don't even, in Presbyterian, you don't even have altar call. So I say, how can kids pray for adults? Will God listen to him? Oh, I have a lot of questions in my mind. But I said, no matter what, I want this. This is what I want. So when I start to pray and pray and pray, more hands laid on top of me. I feel more heavier, because more hands on top of me. So I look around. It's all children praying for me. Over 10, over 15 kids are praying for me. I don't know them, but they're praying for me. At that time, I just feel like, where's the adult? And nobody's there, just children. At that time, I started to feel like this is what God want me to be, like children. Like very, very simple and pure heart to his altar, and then pray and just praise him. When I start to pray and I start to praise him, there's a hard stone inside my heart start to break. The stone break pieces. Before, I never cried. I hardly cried because I was told not to cry in public. And in orphanage, if we cry, we're in trouble. And that's why we hide our emotions very, very well. Even I'm sad, I can be happy. But at that moment, my heart started broken pieces. And then the more hands on top of me, the stone, and the new heart comes into my heart, a soft heart coming into my heart. And I started to feel loved, so much loved that I never had it before. I never been hugged by anybody when I was in orphanage. I never know what love is really about. So at that moment, I realized God really loves me so much that he cared about me. He knows what I have been through in the past. And he said that, you are my only baby. If I don't love you, who's going to love you? I feel like that moment, God held me in his arm. And then I started to cry and cry and cry. Like, feels like 17 years tears that night runs out. All the bad stuff runs out. All the bad negative things runs out. And I sit on the chair. And then for a while, suddenly that's what they told me. I fell on the concrete floor so hard, my head hit it first. And then I don't feel anything. At that time, I just feel like God's love so strong. And then when I fell on the floor, and then I started to speak in tongue that I never had experienced before. I know what I'm saying. I start to praise God, but the words comes out my mouth is another language. And then that night really changed my life. And baptizing the Holy Spirit is not only one thing, one day things. It's continuing, and your life is changing. Since I've been baptized in the Holy Spirit, the biggest change is I know who I am. I know why I'm a sister. I know why God put me in an orphanage. I know why I'm opportunity. I know why my parents, my family is this way. And then God make all the pictures, put it in the right place for me to understand. And after I understand the purpose why I insist, then I know the purpose, what I should do, the next step. And then I start to work with Fari. And I know, I don't know a lot of things, but because I'm willing to serve and I learned lots of things from Fari, and I get to do children's ministry. That's That's my favorite ministry I like to be in because I like to play. So since then, my life is totally changed. I can talk now. Before, I don't talk at all in public. But now I cannot stop. So maybe our service is going to be until 2 o'clock. There's a lot of things and miracles happen. Even there's one big miracle happened to me is I was healed by God. Before, I was very, very anemic. I have a problem with my blood. Because I don't know my medical history, so I have no clue about what's going on with my body. I know I faint a lot. Oh, by the way, talking about faint, that night I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. And when I faint, not faint, I didn't faint, I fall on the floor, and then after 2 hours, I try to get up. I cannot get up because my legs is so weak. I cannot hold myself. But it's different than faint and then filled with the Holy Spirit. I feel so strong the presence of God in me that I cannot stand up right then. I feel the power so strong. So and the next one is when I faint, my legs weak and I start to tingling. Like thousands of ants climb on top of my legs. It's totally different. But before, I don't know why I have that kind of disease. I just know I faint a lot. And on 2003, I'm very, very sick because I work with Fari. We work very hard. We had to move all the sound systems when we do crusade at school, and we had to climb five stories high. At a school, I said, man, it's just early morning. We have to do this workout. Oh, my God. So because of that, I feel like my body can take it. I don't have enough energy and strength. So I pray to God. I say, God, I need to have a good health to serve you. If I don't have a good health to serve you, how can I continue and to witness to people and to reach people? So in 2003, one of the pastors came to our church, and he was giving a testimony. He said, praise the Lord, I was healed by God. Whoa, really? I said, it's a miracle. You know what? I have a very, very bad disease about too much iron. You know, what will happen if you got too much iron in your body? You will hurt your organ and you won't feel good at all. So he has to go to the hospital, take the iron out every week. But me is opposite. I have to take iron in every week. So what I was sitting in the front pew. I said, God, you can heal him. You can heal me too. It doesn't take that long. We're just opposites. So if you can heal him, then you can heal me too. I didn't even come to the altar. I just sit there and pray to God by myself with God. I say, God, I believe you're going to heal me because we're opposites. It doesn't take that long for you to do that. That's a conversation between me and God. So the next day, I went to the hospital to double check with my blood stuff. So Fari went with me. So went to the doctor's office. And then Fari said, she's very sick. And she has a very, very bad about anemic. And the doctor looked at my eyes, looked at my fingers, whatever he's looking at. I said, no, I think she's very healthy. She looks healthier than her age, girls. So Fari said, no. She kept arguing with doctors because she went to the doctors when I have IVs every week, and she's there with me, so she knows my condition. So the doctor said, okay, let's take the blood. So the next week, we see the result. The doctor said, see, her blood cells, everything is normal, and she has no problem. Right then, I was thinking, oh, it's a miracle! I said, it's a miracle. I can't believe it happened to me. I didn't do that, but in my heart, it's just, it's a miracle. And then when I walked out, I said, thank you, doctor. And I walked out, Fari, it's a miracle. Fari said, what? And then I tell her, what did I say, the prayer to God? And then, but since then, sometimes miracles, you feel like it's only one time. Maybe after a few days, things come back again. But no. After I healed by God, my blood cells, everything go to more normal. When I had a cut, usually it takes months to heal. But that moment, just 3 days, like normal people, in 3 days, my cut is healed, is dried. No more bandage. So I said, God, thank you so much. And also, that's the first time I'm so happy to be a woman. Because I don't have enough blood. So I don't have any monthly stuff. So,
okay, we're getting personal now.
But this is real, so you need to know. And so after that day, every month I'm healthy. Until now, never stopped.
All right.
So I really believe that God will do miracles to individual of your life. Doesn't matter what you're going through. So thank you for giving me this opportunity to share with you. And I give my microphone back to Fari.
Wow. Oh, wow. What you see is what you get. That's Linda, and I bet you never forget this mission service. Honestly, to everything that she said, just to back it up real quick, is absolutely true. And I went with her every week to the hospital for her to get blood put in her body every week. And in a moment's time, God healed her. God is at work. He's still God. He still does the impossible if we'll only trust and believe him. I do have a video, Pastor, but it's okay. I'm so sorry for all the time, but I have to tell you, I appreciate so much all that you're doing in Taiwan with us. May God bless you as you watch this video of what you're doing in the island of Taiwan.
Saves, raise a shout to let all the world know. Jesus saves. Raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves.